Welcome to this presentation from the Wisconsin First Detector Network. This video was adapted from a Wisconsin First Detector Network training session. In this video, you'll hear Paul Skawinski from UW Extension Lakes Program talk about invasive aquatic plants.
So the first message, really, that maybe the most important message of the whole presentation is that we want to try to find these things early. As they become more established, they cost a lot more. The likelihood of eradication or really effective control goes way down, and this is a commonly known idea, but it's extremely important to try to recognize things early. And even if you can't recognize something, just knowing who to contact is very important to pass it along and make sure that somebody who would recognize it can do so for you. When we do find something early in Wisconsin, though, at least for aquatic species and wetland species, the Wisconsin DNR does have rapid response grants available. Most of the time, these are applied to populations within lakes. And the rule is if it's less than 5% of the water body and has been discovered in the last 5 years, it's eligible for one of these rapid response grants. So it's a way to help lake associations and other citizen groups fund eradication or control projects. If we look at a list of many of the major invasive wetland plants that we find in this area, there are a lot of them. And looking at another slide where we highlight which ones of these were imported here intentionally for ornamental use, you can see that that's a really common theme. Really the only one that stands out is starry stonewort, which is not something that's typically cultivated in aquaria or water gardens or anything, but the majority of them are or were in the past at one time. It's very common for people to just dump aquariums or thin out plants that are overtaking their water garden and just release them into a local waterway. This is, of course, illegal to do, but people occasionally still do it anyway. They feel a sort of connection with any type of organism in their aquarium or their water garden, and rather than putting it in the trash or freezing it or something like that, they often feel this obligation to let that organism go free and continue its life. But they can cause all kinds of problems when somebody does that, not to mention that it's illegal in the first place. So I did a quick search on Google for water garden, and there are a few of the photographs that came up first. In the foreground here on the in the center is a blooming water hyacinth, which is a prohibited species in Wisconsin. On the lower right and the lower left corners is water lettuce. Both of those species form very dense networks of floating plants. And then we have an exotic water lily there also. We do have white water lilies that are native to Wisconsin, but the flowers do not raise above the surface like the one in the photograph does. So there are a lot of species out there that people commonly import for water garden use that are not native here and have the potential to cause a lot of issues if they become released or escaped into a local waterway. Here's another shot. This is just a wooden barrel with a bunch of water hyacinth clumps in there and then some duckweed. Here's a creative use of an old satellite dish with mostly white water lilies in the middle and some marsh cinquefoil, which is a native species, but then all around the perimeter there's some scattered water hyacinth and water lettuce in there. So you get the idea, they're both very common, those two species in particular, the lettuce and hyacinth, they're extremely commonly imported for ornamental use. So why do people like using invasive species in plantings? The answers are pretty simple. These things are very easily established. They will tolerate terrible maintenance and poor soils, poor drainage, any kind of site that somebody might put them in, they often will survive. So customers are generally pretty happy with them because they're extremely hard to kill and they'll survive basically wherever anybody puts them. You can be extremely ignorant about gardening and still successfully cultivate these plants, so they become very popular with people because they have great success keeping them. Unfortunately, those characteristics that I just talked about are the same characteristics of a good invasive species. So they go hand in hand. The message I'll leave you with is just to focus on early detection, get trained, just try to be able to recognize these different things. And if you find something that you think is suspicious, even if you can't identify it, just know who to contact. I always welcome people to send me photographs of any aquatic or wetland plant that they find, or any aquatic invasive species for that matter. If you find something that you think is suspicious and you're not quite sure feel free to send that to me. Contact your local DNR lakes biologist. Sometimes you have an aquatic invasive species coordinator at the county level. In many cases, you can contact them. So there's a lot of resources out there to help citizens and volunteers detect these species or confirm their presence. So just know who those people are and use them for the resources that they are. You don't have to go out to a lake or a stream with the expressed intent of monitoring. You may just be out fishing or boating or swimming, and just having these images and this knowledge in the back of your mind will be valuable to you as you're out there on the water, and you can recognize these things if you did see them. And as I stated before, if we find these things early, the possibility for eradication is there. The likelihood of a very expensive treatment regime or anything is unlikely, because it's a small pioneer population. It's fairly easily managed and can be done quite effectively for low cost. There's a case in Washera County where we found Eurasian water milfoil several years ago, and it was about 2 acres worth of milfoil, but we were able to hand remove almost half of that with a couple of volunteers via snorkeling mostly, and then did an herbicide treatment on the densest area. We hand pulled the rest of it after that. And although this lake district got a 3-year rapid response grant from the DNR, they only had to use the money for the initial treatment the first year. They ended up giving the rest of the money back to the DNR because they didn't need it anymore. They found this really early population and got on top of it really quickly. And that lake went for 3 years without even being able to find any Eurasian milfoil, even though we had kayakers, snorkelers, scuba divers, all kinds of people looking for it. Nobody could find any for 3 years. And it did show up last fall. We had a few plants show up, but those were quickly just hand-pulled. And again, as of right now, there have not been any Eurasian milfoil plants spotted in the lake yet this year. So that's a great success story, just to point out how effective management can be if you find something early. So with that, there's my contact information. If you want to email me photographs of anything, I certainly welcome that. Or give me a call if you have other questions.
Thanks for watching this video from the Wisconsin First Detector Network. To learn about our network or to access additional information about invasive species in Wisconsin, please visit our website or contact us.